Doing well, dog.
Yeah. Me and all my, yeah, me. Yeah. Me and all my doing well, dawg. You not from the city, I could tell, dawg. Did it by myself, dawg. Blew up and I'm in the city still, I'm still here, dawg. How did I finesse all of the from Jane and Weston? Girls all in my bed and they don't trip off first impression. Girls all in your bed and they just ask 100 questions. I can't f with you no more, cause you be acting extra. Do your favorite rapper like my son, no. Nothing mutual about my funds, though. All you fighting over crumbs, where the bread at? How they feel about you, where you from, where your bed at? I don't need no pill to speak my mind, I don't need that. I make people pay me for my time, yeah.
Welcome back, y'all. This is your host, Trey Corleone, and we're in our 9th episode of TR3LAND, man. And it's been a long, but rather brief journey. But I really feel like this is gonna be our best episode. I feel like a very, very special guest on the phone. And this is really gonna be an entertaining, but knowledgeable episode. So kick your feet up, you know, relax, but also have your ears open. And let's dive right into it. All right, man, let's jump into it. Let's dive into it. This man is an Air Force commission officer, owns 10 rental properties on the Gulf Coast, and also owns his own charity, all at 24, 25 years old. Without further ado, Prescott Williams. All right, man. So without further ado, our special guest for the 9th episode of TR3LAND, Prescott Williams. What's up, bro?
What's up, Trey? How you doing? I appreciate the introduction, man. You make it sound like I'm doing a lot more than I am.
Man, I appreciate you, bro. Like, you know, I kind of keep up with you. You know, we talk back and forth. I know how your schedule can get, bro. So I appreciate you coming in and stopping and taking time to talk with me, bro, and talk with us, really, and talk with us.
We always have a good conversation when we do talk, though, so I figured this go right along that same
path. I feel the same way, that's why I feel like this is gonna be so natural, because we always have this talk, so, like, why not have it on camera and you know, and share it with people, bro?
Yeah.
But, man, like, before I guess I get started, like I said, I know on the top of the video, like, everything it says, an interview, but I really don't want this to be an interview, bro. I want this to be a regular combo, like we chilling, bro. Like, we in the backyard or something, at the crib or something, bro.
And, all right.
Bet, bro. So, like I said, I know this already, but for the people that don't know, where are you from?
Yeah, I went to
Man, hey, we got y'all a few times too, bro. But look, man. So you talked a little bit about past high, well, going to high school. Tell me a little bit about your high school experience, bro. Okay, so you kind of feel like your high school kind of, I guess, built the foundation to where your path and where you're going today type thing. Okay, so I guess kind of keep going with me with your time, your time log, I guess, and your life. So okay, boom, your high school experience. What happens after that, bro? Right.
Well, you can, if you know about all these topics, if you can recite all these speeches by politicians in 1864 and all
right.
that stuff, it doesn't matter. So I took this class called Skills for Success and Financial Planning. A coach was teaching it, so you know I wasn't there to play around.
Yeah.
And he started introducing topics like attitude is everything, to be happy you have to give happy, and then it was followed by financial freedom and passive income. And in the class, they were talking about how you could put $6,500 a year in a retirement account, and based on compound interest, by the time you're 65 years old, you have $3 million in it. So after listening to a couple topics like that, it got me real interested in finances and just becoming successful and learning all the things I need to learn at an age to be super productive and knowledgeable and wealthy in my later life.
Right. Okay. Okay. And like I said, I think I reiterated this earlier. You know, I kind of keep up with you, man. So I just had a few questions, and I feel like other people feel the same way. You know, when did you first? You may have just answered this question, but when did you first know you wanted to get into real estate? I want this to be a conversation, and I don't want this to be like, I don't want to be asking basic questions. I want somebody to really learn something if they want to watch this. So, okay. So, what, I guess when you first started getting along in the real estate game, because I feel like I know a couple people that like either want to get started or they either started early and like kind of quit. What was some of your first serious challenges along the way with your first maybe couple of properties? I remember seeing they ain't them helping you build the house and stuff. I remember
it was
that.
Rough, man. I was living in an air mattress inside the house for about 2.5 months.
Okay.
AC or heat, I bought one of the portable AC heaters in there.
Yeah.
Every day, me and my dad And not worth like 150, and it's beautiful. It's within 2 minutes of USM's campus.
Huh. Location, location, location.
In Major University in Southern Mississippi.
Yes. Long game, long game. And I'm telling you, a lot of what you said made a lot of sense, especially what you saying, you had to dive, you said you had to dive in deep into these books. That, and I feel like that's with anything, you gotta do your homework before you just wanna become a master and get deep at it, or like make a real risk. You get what I'm saying?
So yeah,
Invest before you invest. Yeah. Come on. Come on.
So the thing is, like, people ask me questions all the time. Well, I want to buy this house, this, and this, and they already going to the deal. But you didn't read those 600 one-hour episode podcasts I listened to. Yeah. You didn't reach that poor dad and Set for Life and the book on managing rental properties. And that's what it takes. And I mean, there's so many times in our life where, like, we're stuck in the interim period. When I was in nursing school, I was broke. There's no way I could have bought properties. But the one thing I could do at that time was learn. And so whatever you maximize your time, that you can do to maximize your productivity at the time, you got to do it. And for that, for me, that was learning. So I invested before I invested.
Bro, that's profound. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. So You really, by us expanding, we really got a grand gist of a lot of my questions. Let me look. Okay, this is really my favorite question I wanted to ask you. This is a hypothetical one though.
Okay, come on.
Okay, so say boom, it's a new world, and you're you. You have all the knowledge that you have today, but you have $0. That's what I'm saying. You slick went into it, but I want you to get into more detail. If somebody had $0 in nothing, you know, what would you do to start in real estate?
I had a knowledge.
Yeah. They're going to be a billionaire. They're going to run it back up.
Yeah, people think that people luck in the wealth. It's learned. So with the connections that I have now, as far as I know every real estate agent on the coast.
Right.
I know contractors. Heck, my dad's a contractor. I know not everything about real estate, because there's so many things to know. But as far as foundational knowledge, I got it all in my head.
Yeah.
So with the things that I know now, graduated high school and went to the shipyard, which was initially my plan. Go to the shipyard in Ingalls and go pay $22 an hour, and I guarantee you I get to 10 rental properties faster than I did going around that I went.
They're
not the most important thing.
Yeah.
Money. Once you understand money, the money's gonna come. But you gotta have knowledge. You gotta have knowledge first.
A lot, and I'm asking these questions, but I need to hear a lot of this. A lot of this hitting for me, bro. So that's crazy that you say that, man. Okay, so what you went into a lot about, I guess, the books you've been reading and the podcasts that you've been listening to. So I give the whole Prescott Williams playbook, some podcasts or books that you really listen to it, helped you to get where you at.
I'm happy you said you asked this, because I feel like podcasts and books have like became me. Right. I'm gonna start with 5 podcasts probably that'll kill it for y'all. Maybe not 5, but I'm gonna talk about it.
Whatever one's on your head, bro, tell, like, let us know.
Bigger Pockets changed my life. Bigger Pockets is the number one real estate podcast in the world. You need to go through one through, there's like 650 episodes. Huh. You need to listen. And guess what? It didn't cost me any time. The only difference is when I was in the car Dre, Jordan Lucas, all these, Adele, Rihanna, all these people y'all listen to. Guess what I was listening to? Podcasts. I was getting my education on the road.
On the road.
Education on the road every day. I learned more on my drive to college some days than I learned when I was in school.
Okay. Okay.
Podcasts, Bigger Pockets Podcast. They have a rookie show. They have all types of different subsidiaries of it. They have a show called Millionaire Mindsets. It's by a young black guy called Xavier. Amazing podcast. He talks to lots of young millionaires and people that are young and just doing amazing things. Earn Your Leisure. I know you probably heard of Earn Your Leisure.
I've heard of it. I haven't I'm disappointed in myself. I haven't listened to it, but I've heard of it.
They just had Master P on the episode. And if anybody knows the story of Master P, this man has done everything that's ever needed to be done.
A legend. Right.
So I start there. Bigger Pockets, Earn Your Leisure, Millionaire Mindsets. And they have some other shows like I've been listening to the Self Storage Podcast, but that's more like niche focused on the topic. But if you really listen to those big three, they have, if you want to build a business, this is one I listen to called How We Built This by Guy Raz. It's an NPR podcast, I believe. Yeah. It's big. I start with those four podcasts, and you said books too, right?
Yeah. Yeah, give us like two or three books, too.
Now, books, man, let me tell you. I try to tell everybody, if you had to start reading about, like, general success or finances or just books about life, I follow these books in this order. This is the route I read them in.
Right. Lock in.
Book number one is The Alchemist. The Alchemist is a book. It's kind of spiritual, not religious, spiritual.
Yeah.
But
read all that, but like it's been peace. Like, yeah, so that book has been passed down to me. Yeah, okay, I know about that one.
The Richest Man in Babylon, people need to get that to all their kids.
Right.
That's like handing your kids $10 million. Because yeah. If you read Man in Babylon, the book is only like 100 pages, Trey. It's a super small book, it's about this big.
Yeah.
It was written in like biblical times, The Richest Man in Babylon, and it's principles about money and finances that still last today.
That still. Right.
It teaches you about paying yourself first, living below your means, not keeping up with the Joneses. It teaches you the proper way to pay off debt. It teaches you about credit, everything. Richest Man, that's my number two book. Number three, I know you heard this one. The Richest Man of Babylon by Robert Kiyosaki. Yeah, I know. Come on, Trey. I'm sending that book to you. You gotta get it.
Do it right. Yeah, bro. So tell me about that one. I haven't read it, but I've heard it like over radio, like over radio. My pop used to play it, but keep going.
Rich Dad Poor Dad. If when you read that book, it was just like all these lights in my head just started firing off, and I was like, oh, this is how people get wealthy. This is how people become billionaires. This is how you do this. This is how you do that. Because Rich Dad Poor Dad is a mind opener book, because through a whole life, education. And that's not a bad thing or a good thing, because you need employees and you need people to do jobs well.
Right.
Rich Dad Poor Dad teaches you that that's not the only path. It teaches you that you can empower yourself by creating jobs for other people, and that you don't have to do everything thinking how. You can think, who can do this for me? Who can do this? And you can build a team, and you can build businesses, and you can get passive income through real estate. And That's probably my second favorite book.
And the crazy thing, I guess the reason I'm disappointed in myself, I feel like that book is like close by somewhere. Like I feel like I can go grab it right now.
It's everywhere. It's the big time seller.
Yeah.
Book And that's through bank, that's through compound interest, life insurance, and 401ks, Roth IRAs. He told you about which cars you should buy, buying cars that are 2 years old, because that's when you get the most back for your buck. He teaches you about how to build your credit, how to live below your means, everything. Like, that one of the most impactful books that's, like, focused on a specific age group. So, except for, like, I'm
telling
you, I'm
gonna
send you this booklet.
Send them all. You gotta send, like I said, send the whole playbook. Okay, hold on.
Yes, it was in time. Yeah. You sit and you pray, hoping that the stars align. My luck is a sure thing, cause I'm living right. When I needed you, you couldn't give me any advice. You always had something to say every other time. Everybody that I met on the way tries to get in the way. I'm fooling and serving them all like I work for minimum wage. Someone up there must just love testing my patience. Someone up there must be in need of some entertainment. Forgiveness for your way.